Today's special colloquium speaker, Professor Dipankar Bhattacharya, is currently at IUCA for the last 15 years or so. And except perhaps for some of the very new students, Professor Bhattacharya does not need an introduction. He's a towering figure with a wide range of major contributions in different areas of higher energy astrophysics that are well recognized worldwide. Some of the RRA students may not know that he started his astrophysics career at RRI. He joined the Joint Astronomy Program in the very beginning, in the very first year, and did his PhD work at RRI, working with Professor Srinivasan on the pulsars and supernova remnant. And since then, in a very long career, spanning about four decades, he has made major contributions in many areas. I cannot name all of those here. However, I must mention a few key areas. For example, formation and evolution of binary and millisecond radio pulsars, magnetic field structure and evolution in neutron stars of various kinds. He led the GRB afterglow studies that was carried out from India in the first decade of the century. He's also interested in electromagnetic follow-up of gravitational wave sources. And in parallel to all of these, for two decades now, from very beginning of the conception of AstroSat, he has laid many of the efforts on AstroSat with particular contribution towards various aspects of the cadmium zinc telluride imaging instrument and the science support cell at IUCA. He has also led the science working group of AstroSat. So one of the instruments of AstroSat that you will hear about today, the cadmium zinc telluride imager, though it is not originally designed for polarization measurement, has been useful for observation of some of the brightest X-ray sources. So today we look forward to hear about these results in a broader scientific context and what possibly lies ahead, because of X-ray polarization is a mostly unexplored area, a topic for the future, hopefully not far in future. So Professor Bhattacharya, you can start.
Thank you, Vishwajit, for this generous introduction. And thank you for inviting me to speak in this forum, all the organizers, all the students. It's a pleasure for me to speak to you. I chose this topic of polarized high energy emission because of the activity anchored majorly at RRI for the next polarization mission that India is planning. So hopefully you will find this relevant and interesting. So let me get started. So what I want to speak to you about on a sort of a broad sweep through various aspects of polarized high energy emission from astrophysical sources. So I want to, my talk will be divided mainly into three parts. One is, initially I will just discuss various ways of the origin of the polarized high energy emission, how polarized high energy emission can arise, in what kind of sources. Then a little bit about detection methods, which are currently ongoing, has happened before, and what is planned for the future. And then towards the end, I will say something about the sources for which polarization have been detected, and what does the detection of polarization tell us about these sources? So let's start. So origin of high energy polarization, just because it is a high energy doesn't mean that the origin of polarization is any different from any other band of electromagnetic waves. So the polarization of radiation, we can go back to the description of radiation from individual charged particles, and this picture can be built from there. So a charged particle, if it is accelerated, then it emits radiation. This is a basic electromagnetic theory everybody knows. And if I look at a very short duration of this emission from any charged particle, then at that instant, I can write the electric vector that the charged particle emits as a cross product of these three vectors. N is the direction of propagation, that's the line of sight. Beta is the speed of the charge divided by speed of light. And beta dot is the derivative of beta, so it is the acceleration. So given the fact that at any given point of time, these three vectors have specified direction, the electric vector, therefore, is also a defined direction at any instant of time. So if you just look at a very short duration for every charged particle, you will say that the emitted radiation is 100% polarized. But when we look at radiation from a real source, we average this in many ways. First of all, for a given charged particle, we don't look at the emission from an instant, but averaged over the trajectory of the particle for some time. And then the source contains many, many emitting charges, and they're all moving in different directions at any given time. So this emission that we see is also an average over the distribution of emitting charged particles. So if the situation in the source is more or less isotropic, so that the charged particle move randomly in any given direction, and the acceleration by and large is isotropic when you look at the whole distribution of charges, then the net polarization that you will get by adding all of them will be zero. So if you want to have a non-zero net polarization, it requires some kind of anisotropy, either in the motion of charges or in the distribution of charges or in the geometry of the source, one of these things. And it is always a requirement that there has to be an isotropic distribution of the charged particle motion to be able to generate net polarized emission that you observe. So let's keep that in mind. We'll come back to this as we proceed. So now let's move a little forward with single particle emission and look at single particle emission in different contexts. Let's say we have a charged particle in a magnetic field. Then a charged particle in a magnetic field, for simplicity, let us assume the charged particle is moving perpendicular to the magnetic field in this diagram. Then it describes a circular orbit. The acceleration is the centripetal acceleration in this orbit. What kind of radiation polarization that we will see of this radiation, of the radiation generated by this charged particle? If we look at it from the direction normal to the orbit, then we would see a circular polarization. On the other hand, if we look at it in the orbital plane, we'll see a linear polarization. So the charged particle in a magnetic field produces strongly polarized radiation, and the nature of polarization will depend on the viewing angle with respect to the orbit of the particle. In many cases, in astronomy, we encounter charged particles moving in a magnetic field, but those charged particles are moving at a very high speed, relativistic speed. So what you get is not just a synchrotron radiation, but cyclotron radiation, but synchrotron radiation. So in case of synchrotron radiation, what happens is that the radiation pattern, which you saw like a figure of eight in the previous diagram, is now highly beamed and beamed in the direction of the motion of the particle, instantaneous motion of the particle. So this is the speed of the particle, then the radiation is highly beamed in this direction. And as the charged particle executes its orbit, and if you happen to be looking at it from some direction like this, which is marked as K, this beam sweeps across you. So you don't see emission all through the orbit, certainly not at the same intensity, but only strongly seen at a certain short duration of the orbit through which this cone crosses your line of sight. So if you look at the electric vector that arrives at you, it will have big spikes like this with a very small value at the rest of the during the rest of the orbit. So this causes the spectrum to become much wider, and you get high frequency emission. But we are interested in polarization in this case, and the polarization of synchrotron radiation for a charged particle moving in a magnetic field. Now, if I also include the component of motion parallel to the magnetic field, then it will describe a helix. And the polarization that the observer will see will have a component which is perpendicular to the magnetic field and one which is parallel to the magnetic field. Now, if we add radiation from a whole bunch of charged particles which have different angles with respect to the magnetic field and different velocity distribution, the component parallel to the magnetic field averages out. So what you are left with is this component which is perpendicular to the magnetic field. So the net polarization of synchrotron radiation is perpendicular to the projected magnetic field in the sky. What is the degree of this polarization? That can be described. That's a function of the energy distribution of the charged particles. A typical synchrotron spectrum looks like this. If you have a charged particle distribution where the energy, number of particles as a function of energy is a power law, with a power law index P, then you have a standard synchrotron spectrum which has a slope. It's a power law spectrum with a slope of minus P minus 1 by 2. And then at higher energies where you have electrons radiating energy at a higher rate than you're putting in, then you get a tired electrons and you get minus P by 2. And at lower energies, if the material becomes optically thick at a frequency which is higher than the lowest frequency that the power law distribution is going to generate, then you have a slope which is new to the plus 2.5. But if it is at lower frequency than the lower cutoff of the particle energy spectrum, the frequency corresponding to that, then you have plus 2. And the region between plus 2 and the end of the minus P minus 1 by 2 spectrum is joined by a plus 1/3 segment. We will come back to this towards the end of the talk when we look at the spectra of gamma ray bursts. So this power law index P determines how much polarization you will see from a spectrum like this. So as a function of power law index P, if you look at the net maximum polarization fraction, then for a fully ordered magnetic field, then you will have a polarization of the order of about 70 to 75% for a typical power law index which we see in sources. That is around about 2, sometimes a little higher than 2, in a few cases even below 2. But over that range, the net polarization expected from a fully ordered magnetic field will be about 70%, which is a very large polarization. So synchrotron radiation, all synchrotron emitting sources are expected to produce high polarization. And this is routinely seen in radio wavelengths. In radio wavelengths, measurement of polarization is quite routine. And one does see for synchrotron emitting sources measurable high degree of polarization. But this is expected even at higher energies if the synchrotron radiation is contributing to this higher energy emission. Then another method of generating high energy photons in astrophysical sources is Compton scattering. So you have regions which are full of high energy electrons, and when such a high energy electron interacts with a low energy photon, you have what is called the inverse Compton effect. So the low energy photon is boosted to high energies like X-rays and gamma rays. And this process can generate a significant amount of polarization depending on geometry. The cross section for that kind of scattering drops significantly if in the rest frame of the electron, the incoming photon has an energy larger than the rest energy of the electron. But at lower incoming energies of the photon, the scattering efficiency is high, and the cross section is more or less equal to the Thomson cross section. So if you have a Thomson scattering, let's say in the rest frame of the electron, and you have an incident radiation, let's say the incident radiation is polarized with an electric field in the plane of this diagram, then you can imagine that this electric field will set the electron in motion. The electron will be accelerated as shown by this blue line here. And that acceleration will cause radiation. And that radiation will have a scattered electric field, will be the scattered produce the scattered electric field. And the amount of radiation will be dependent on the projection, basically, of this acceleration in that direction. So now assume that the incident electric field is in the plane of this diagram, and you are viewing at an angle which is perpendicular to this angle of incidence, but in the plane of this diagram. Then to that observer, the electron does not show any motion at all, and you don't get any electric field. So therefore, for incident radiation which is polarized in the plane of this diagram, you don't get any scattered radiation 90 degrees on the same in the same plane. But if the incident electric field happens to be perpendicular to this to the plane of this diagram, so suppose the incident radiation is unpolarized, and you have both this component and the component perpendicular to this diagram, so then that component will set the electron in motion perpendicular to this plane, and the observer who is sitting on this plane along this line will see the full motion, and you get a complete polarized radiation perpendicular to the plane of this diagram. So you have unpolarized radiation, but in that direction, you have a fully polarized, 100% polarized scattered radiation going out. And in all other intermediate angles, you can have a varying degree of polarization. So this scattering, Thomson scattering or Compton scattering, is capable of producing extremely high degree of radiation polarization when the geometry is suitable. So here I have shown, as a function of scattering angle, the polarization fraction and the scattered power. So the polarization fraction rises to 100% at 90 degrees, while the scattered power drops to about half from maximum near forward scattering. So let's remember that, and that's that can give us fairly strong polarization in several astrophysical situations. For example, if you have accreting black hole system, let's say you have a black hole and a companion star. Companion star is supplying matter to the black hole. The matter comes in as an accretion disk, and this accretion disk is a thin entity, and as it approaches the black hole, it gets hotter and hotter. So the outer parts of the black hole are less hot, and the main process of interaction of radiation with the material there is free emission and absorption. Whereas as the material gets hotter and hotter and proceeds inside close to the black hole, the temperature rises so much that the dominant process of interaction of photon with matter becomes scattering, electron scattering. And electron scattering, as I have just mentioned, can produce high degree of polarization. And so here, because the material itself is distributed in a thin disk, the scattered radiation will have a net electric field, which is lying on the plane of the disk. It's parallel to the plane of the disk. But at different parts of the disk, it will have different orientation. So the net polarization that you will see will depend on your view angle with respect to the plane of the disk. If you're viewing the disk at 90 degrees, that is, you're viewing the disk along the plane, 90 degrees to the axis of the disk, then you get the maximum polarization, which works out to be about 12%. And as you go to a more and more face-on disk, this fraction will reduce. So just due to Thomson scattering, accreting black hole source can produce fairly significant polarization of the order of 12% in X-rays, because the inner parts of the disk from which this emission is coming is very hot, and the natural emission band is in X-rays. So you have polarized X-rays being emitted in this situation. Objects like this don't just have the disk, but often they have an outflow, particularly close to the black hole, in a collimated jet-like structure. Now, if photons scatter from that bulk high-speed outflow, then you can get even more polarization. And so any source which has a jet-like structure can produce higher polarization, A, due to scattering from such bulk flow, and B, such jets often also contain relativistic material which produce non-thermal emission, synchrotron emission. And the synchrotron emission can add to the polarized emission that you are otherwise going to see from scattering. So the scattering and non-thermal emission in associated jets may show higher degree of polarization. So not only in this accreting black holes that I just mentioned, but similar systems like active galactic nuclei or gamma ray bursts also are expected to produce high polarization because of the huge anisotropy that jets present to us. Staying with accreting objects, the other class of accreting objects that can give rise to very strong polarization are accreting strongly magnetized neutron stars. Now here, the inner part of the disk gets truncated because the strong magnetic field stops the accretion disk flow, and then matter sort of rides on the magnetic field and arrives at the poles of the neutron star. So the degree of polarization that you would have seen from the inner part of the disk due to the scattering, like in black holes, is less dominant in neutron star systems like this. But this flow, which is guided by the magnetic field, interacts with the magnetic field, and that interaction can produce emission which can be very strongly polarized. So what do we expect? We expect this matter to be guided by the magnetic field and come to the magnetic pole, and it settles down on the magnetic pole. So if you take a look close to the magnetic pole, you have this stellar crust. Matter is coming, guided by those field lines. There is a free fall region, then there is a shock, and then hot matter then proceeds towards the stellar crust. And this hot matter produces most of the emission that you see from this accreting object. And this hot matter, therefore, is sitting in a region which is bathed in very strong magnetic field. So this magnetic field could be of Tera-Gauss range. And what you do have in the interaction between material here, photons, and the strong magnetic field is what's called magneto-Compton scattering. So we talked about Compton scattering before, but once you add magnetic field, its character changes somewhat. So you can have radiation interacting with magnetic field. We'll look at radiation of two different kinds, one in which the polarization of the radiation is parallel to the magnetic field. The electric vector is parallel to the magnetic field. So let's call that extraordinary mode. And the other, where the polarization is perpendicular to the magnetic field, let's call that ordinary mode. So now, if you look at the scattering of this radiation from electrons, which are present in that region, the radiation which has its electric vector parallel to the magnetic field actually does not pose any hindrance to the motion of the electron in that direction. So magnetic field is present, but the electrons can move freely along the magnetic field. So for so if you look at an electron scattering radiation which has electric vector parallel to the magnetic field, then it behaves just like the standard Thomson scattering. So it's scattering cross-section is flat over here, which is at 10 to the power of 0. This is scattering cross-section in units of Thomson scattering cross-section. So this is parallel to parallel. But if you look at the electric vector perpendicular to the magnetic field, then the electrons can be set in motion perpendicular to the magnetic field, but then once the electron moves perpendicular to the magnetic field, then it will gyrate and produce cyclotron orbits. And with this strong magnetic field, we are in a regime where we are looking at quantized levels. So the quantized Landau levels. So you have quantized orbits, and these represent resonances. So you have resonances at the fundamental and all its harmonics. So going from a perpendicular to perpendicular photon state scattering, you have these very strong resonances. And that occurs also in perpendicular to parallel and parallel to perpendicular. You see these resonances in all of them. So now these resonances, while we are looking at the two polarizations, and clearly we see that the behavior of the two components of the polarization are quite different. So when you sum it up at the total radiation, when it emerges, you will then see the intensities of these two components altered differently. And as a result, particularly near resonances, you will see a very strong polarization. In addition to this, when the magnetic field is very strong, you also have the effect of vacuum polarization. So in addition to the plasma, which is already present, the vacuum polarization creates electron-positron pairs and adds to this plasma, and that changes the refractive index of the material. So as a result, so here is a plot of the refractive index, departure of the refractive index from one, multiplied by a certain factor. And so these dashed lines is the refractive index of the plasma in absence of vacuum polarization. But when you add the effect of vacuum polarization, you can see the refractive index changes considerably. And this effect also adds to the polarizing effect when the photon propagates through this plasma. And what you have is a net effect of the resonant scattering from the plasma plus vacuum polarization. So these can be added together And then when you do a radiative transfer, you can take a look at what is the net polarization that you will achieve. So here is a calculation done in the 80s of radiation propagating through this kind of plasma. So you add the effects of magnetocompton scattering, vacuum polarization, and so on. And the two modes are shown here. The squares and the circles are the two different modes. The circles are the ordinary mode, the squares are the extraordinary mode. So you can see that at the resonance, the intensity of these two modes differ by almost a factor of 10. So if they differ by almost a factor of 10, then you are going to get almost 90% polarized light coming out at these frequencies. And of course, as you go away from this, the degree of polarization will drop. These triangles show you the total emission by summing these two. So as a result of this, when you look at the emission from this neutron star, which also rotates, so because of this small hotspot, which is formed when the material strikes the surface, as the neutron star rotates, you will see a variable degree of degree of emission, variable intensity of emission. So these are also called accreting X-ray pulsars. So here are some computations from this exercise, again in the late 80s. So these are different energy bands, and you have the pulse shape as a function of phase in these different energy bands. These are for different angles, different angle between the spin axis and the magnetic axis, and the different angle between the spin axis and the view axis. So this is the first, the view axis angle, second is the magnetic field axis angle. So, so this computation has been done for various geometries. So let's take a look at this one, for example. So as you go as a function of energy, this is for a pencil beam, see the change in the shape of the pulse profile, and you can see very strong modulation of the pulse profile, and these are the resonance energies. So these two energy bins are close to resonance energies. And this shows the degree of polarization. So you can see that those cases where you're close to the resonant energy, energy bin number 5 and 6, you can see that there is a strong change in polarization as the pulsar moves through. So very strong polarization signature can be got from these objects. So this is expectation. I mean, these computations can be further improved. There are various groups around the world who are now trying to modernize these calculations, include other effects, particularly the light bending and various other effects that will cause some more averaging of these numbers. But you do expect really strong polarization coming out of these objects as you see it moving through your line of sight as a function of phase, rotating through your line of sight. So this is an expectation. This has so far, this experiment has not so far been carried out with sufficient sensitivity to be able to detect this polarization yet, but hopefully, as we'll see, in the near future, we are going to be able to observe some of these things. So that was a quick survey of the situations where we do expect strong polarization at high energies in cosmic setting. So let me go through again a few of principles of detection which are being applied to actually observe them. Detection of polarization at high energies is extremely challenging. It has been extremely challenging because, first of all, the paucity of photons, the number of photons that you get at high energies are far, far lower than at lower energies like in optical or radio. And secondly, all these detection techniques also have many instrumental systematics. A very clear characterization of those systematics are necessary Otherwise, the detectable degree of polarization could be hidden in the instrumental systematics. So both these have proven to be very great challenges. And one is now slowly beginning to overcome some of them. So let's look at some of the techniques that have been employed. The very first detector that actually did detect X-ray polarization was a Bragg reflection polarimeter, where you have a crystal, here it was a graphite, and you have a radiation incoming, an incident on this crystal, and Bragg reflecting in a certain direction. Of course, the Bragg condition has to be satisfied, so therefore this experiment can only be done at very narrow energy bands. So this one worked at two energy bands, 2.6 kV and its first harmonic 5.2 kV. So you cannot do a continuum exercise with this kind of detector. But what does happen is that in this kind of scattering, just as we talked about in Thomson scattering, something similar happens here too. Suppose this incident radiation is unpolarized and you have a component which is in the plane and another component shown by circle which is perpendicular to the plane. So when you have this scattering, depending on the angle between the two, the in-plane component is significantly reduced while perpendicular to the plane component goes through completely. So an incident unpolarized radiation will be polarized on scattering. An incident polarized radiation will preferentially be scattered perpendicular to the plane. And so that anisotropy in the scattering can be detected. And particularly to do that, here you can rotate this crystal around the incident direction and then measure this scattered intensity as a function of angle. And that is what was done. And the very first detection of cosmic source, that is Crab Nebula, was made by this Weissauer polarimeter in the 70s, late 1970s. And since then, there has been a big drought in the polarimetry arena at high energies. What has been employed and is still being employed quite successfully is a scattering polarimeter, which is not exactly a Bragg reflection polarimeter, but Thomson or Compton scattering polarimeter, where you have a scatterer and you have incident radiation, and the incident radiation can then scatter at various angles. And the scattering cross-section is given by this Kleinian cross-section, which I have written it out here. And you can see that there are two angles which are involved. One is this angle with respect to the incident axis, which is theta, and this angle with respect to the incident plane of polarization, that is phi. So the scattering cross-section has this term, which is minus 2 sine squared theta cos squared phi. So the maximum of the scattering occurs when, for a given theta, when phi is 90 degrees. So, so you have a preferential scattering at phi at 90 degrees. So if you look at the azimuthal distribution of scattered photons at an angle which is 90 degrees with respect to the incident polarization vector, you will see enhancement in the scattered photons. So if you're able to detect the distribution, azimuthal distribution of photons, then if the incident radiation happens to be polarized, then you will be able to determine its polarization, both degree as well as angle. So since you need Compton scattering, and the Compton scattering has to be significant, or even Thomson scattering has to be significant over other processes like photoelectric absorption and so on. So this kind of detector is effective typically at higher photon energies, above about 10 kilo electron volts. So it doesn't quite work at soft X-rays. But this has been used as well as planned to use, is being planned to use even in some future detectors, including POLEX. So this POLEX is in development at RRI, and Vishwajit can apprise you more about it, where the design has a scatterer, which is a beryllium scatterer at the center, surrounded by a set of proportional counters. And these proportional counters then detect the azimuthal distribution of the scattered photons. And then this whole instrument is spun along its axis to reduce the systematic possible systematic effects that can occur due to inherent anisotropy of these detectors. So that is in advanced stage of production, and hopefully it will be launched soon. We are all waiting for it, so that we expect a significant number of sources to be detected by this POLIX instrument, including some of the accreting X-ray pulsars that I talked about. The ASTROSAT mission, which is currently flying, has one of the instruments, which is cadmium zinc telluride imager, which employs a pixelated cadmium zinc telluride detector array in the detector plane. And this can act as a Compton scattering polarimeter. It acts in the following manner. Suppose radiation is incident from a certain direction, and let's say it has a certain polarization, plane of polarization. That photon can Compton scatter in one of the pixels of the CZTI. So in the CZTI detector, one of the pixels, the first pixel that it encounters with, let's say it Compton scatters, and in the Compton scattering, some amount of energy is deposited in the scattered electron in this pixel, which is detected in this pixel, but the photon is scattered and is detected in a neighboring pixel. So that distribution of the scattered photons in the neighboring pixels will have a maximum in a direction which is perpendicular to the incident polarization. So if we look at the azimuthal distribution of the detected photons around this pixel, then you will see a modulation of this kind. And this modulation then tells you, existence of this modulation tells you that this radiation is polarized, and the amplitude of it gives you the fraction, and the phase of it gives you the angle. So that's how the through these double pixel Compton events, ASTROSAT CZTI is able to detect polarization. It works in the range of 100 to 380 kilo electron volts. So it doesn't work at lower energies, because the Compton scattering in CZTI, we are able to detect only above 100 kilo electron volts. There are other future missions which will also employ Compton polarimeters. Currently also, for example, the Integral mission works in the principle of Compton polarimetry. The Polar mission, which was launched and worked for about 7 months, also used Compton polarimetry. And future missions like Daksha and Compton spectrometer and imager, Polar 2, they will all use Compton polarimetry. So, and they will be at relatively high energies. To go to low energies, some significantly different technique is needed. And this was sort of developed in the lab in the early 2000s, and where the photoelectric process is utilized. So just like in scattering, in photoelectric processes also, the probability of ejection of photoelectron is angle dependent. So if the incoming photon has a plane of polarization over here, then as a function of this theta and phi, the probability of photoelectron production is given as this. So it's cos squared phi sine squared theta. So just like we saw in scattering, this has a cos squared phi dependence. And so the ejected photoelectron has the probability of being detected, of being ejected preferentially in the plane of the, parallel to the plane of the incoming polarization. So if we are able to find the direction in which the photoelectron was ejected, So that has to be done by letting the photoelectron etch a track somewhere and then measuring that track. So that kind of detector will then be able to find the track of this photoelectron in the which way it was ejected, and any asymmetry or in the azimuthal distribution of it will tell us about the polarization of the incoming radiation. So gas pixel detectors have been developed to do this. So they can be used to image the track of the photoelectron, and this then extends the polarimetric capability down to about 2 kilo electron volts. This detector has not yet flown in practice so far, but the future missions over the next few years all plan to use detectors of this kind. That is, imaging X-ray polarimeter experiment, the European Chinese EXTP mission, then the ESA's XIPE mission, they all plan to use gas pixel detectors to image photoelectrons to extend polarimetry down to 2 kilo electron volts. This is a major gain because the number of photons increase to a very large number as you go to lower energies, and the polarimetry will become much more sensitive as you are able to carry it out at lower and lower photon energies. So let's now go to a description of the sources, known sources of high energy polarization. So far, among persistent sources we know, only 2 sources have high energy polarization reported. One is the Crab Nebula and Pulsar, which I said was already detected in the 1970s, and that still remains the main target for all new polarization detectors. So this has been detected by various missions, various detectors. Cygnus X1, which is a black hole binary, this is the only binary X-ray source for which polarization detection has been reported, and about a dozen gamma ray bursts. So this is the full complement of sources for which high energy polarization is known. Now let's look at a little bit more detail in individual sources. So Crab Nebula and Pulsar, Crab Pulsar at high energies has a pulse profile which is somewhat different from at low, at radio, for example. It's got a wide pulse profile with a bridge. In radio, you have 2 components. And but these align quite significantly well. In many other radio pulsars, the gamma ray and X-ray emission does not quite align with the radio pulse profile. In Crab, it does. So you have these different regions, which are named off-pulse, bridge, peak 1, peak 2, and so on. And people have tried to do high-energy polarization measurement at these various ranges. A quick recap that in radio, the Crab pulsar has a certain pattern of polarization. This is a fractional polarization as a function of phase, the position angle as a function of phase. This is a 1.4 gigahertz, 4.8 gigahertz, a similar diagram. At optical also, the Crab pulsar polarization has been measured quite well. And this polarization pattern differs quite considerably from what is seen in radio. So indicating that the emission region of much of the radio emission and the optical emission are significantly different. So the pulse profile at higher energies mimic a bit the optical pulse profile rather than the radio pulse profile. So one might expect that the polarization properties will be similar to optical. But this effort has been going on for some time to try to detect the Crab polarization. So the OSO8 Bragg reflection polarimeter detected the polarization of the Crab. They did not try to measure the polarization of the pulsed portion, but the off pulse mainly, and found a strongly polarized emission. So this is the modulation curve as the detector rotated and when it is pointed to the Crab, and this is when it is not. So from a background region, you don't see modulation, but on Crab you do see. So this gives you a measure of the polarization, both the angle and the degree. So and later, the integral mission 2008. They reported the crab polarization in 0.1 to 1 MeV range. So the previous detection was at 2.6 kV and 5.2 kV. These are 100 kV to 1 MeV range. And so integral SPI. And the, for these different regions, off pulse, pulse bridge, and the two peaks, there was a slight difference in the, this is the polarization fraction, this is the polarization angle. So a slight difference in polarization angle was noticed. The later experiment on balloon, Pogolite in 2013, also looked at crab and found that the polarization angle lies in our 140 to 150 degree range with a polarization fraction of about 20%. Enhanced balloon experiment, Pogo Plus, also had similar results with polarization angle around about 140 degrees and polarization fraction of about 20%. And then Astrosat CZTI, we put together a long exposure by adding many observations, and we found in 100 to 380 kV range, where we were able to measure, the polarization fraction was about 30%, and polarization angle is about, again, 140 degrees or so. So this is interesting. So the signal to noise of the measurement that we were able to carry out using the Astrosat CZTI allowed us to do a phase resolved polarimetry. So as a function of phase, you can see the angle plotted here and the polarization fraction plotted here. These are the modulation curves. So you can see the polarization fraction on an average stays about 30% or so. And the polarization angle is sort of steady in this direction, which also happens to be the projected direction of spin of the crab pulsar in the plane of the sky. So what does that tell us? There are subtle variations in this polarization curve, which I'm not going to go into today. But the gross fact that the overall polarization is parallel to the projected spin axis of the pulsar in the sky tells us something as to where the radiation may be originating. So this has to do with the pulsar magnetosphere and where you expect the high energy emission to originate. So over the years, the pulsar magnetosphere has remained a bit of an enigma. There are many, many different theories telling us different locations of the origin of emission at various frequencies. But over the last decade or so, the advent of numerics has significantly changed the situation regarding our understanding of the magnetosphere. So now ab initio calculations of the full magnetosphere is possible. And the overall characteristics of a magnetosphere is summarized here, that you tend to have a closed magnetosphere where field lines close within the light cylinder, light cylinder being the distance at which the co-rotation speed with the neutron star is equal to the speed of light. So within that, field lines close. And this remains a closed magnetosphere, relatively inactive. And then there are open field lines where charged particles that are produced, tend to drift out of the magnetosphere through these lines. And in the equatorial plane, there is a current sheet. And this current sheet then wraps around the boundary of the closed field lines and then produces a separatrix. And what appears from the present calculations is that this current sheet and the separatrix become unstable to pair production very easily, and they become the most active regions of charged particle production as well as generation of radiation. So here is a result from one such calculation where the inclination of the spin axis and the magnetic axis between them is about 30 degrees. And you see this current sheet and the part of the separatrix, which become the brightest regions in high energy photons. So if this is true, then most of the radiation that you expect to come from this kind of magnetosphere is from very near the light cylinder or just outside it. The nature of the magnetic field lines there is mostly toroidal. Whereas as you come closer and closer to the surface of the neutron star, it becomes more and more polarizing. So these toroidal field lines form a kind of toroidal structure in the equatorial plane. And if you have synchrotron radiation in that toroidal magnetosphere, the direction of polarization will lie perpendicular to that, which will lie parallel to the spin axis. Because this plane of this toroidal magnetosphere is the equator, rotational equator of the neutron star. So this sort of the observations sort of emphasize the fact that you are probably seeing the emission from this region rather than from very close within the magnetosphere. There are, of course, many details to be sorted out, and further observations are needed to study this in more detail. Cygnus X1 is a black hole X-ray binary for which the OSO8 put an upper limit of about a few percent at 2.6 keV, but the integral satellite reported a detection at energies greater than 400 keV and a very strong polarization of 65%. POGO Plus has recently put an upper limit of about 5.6% at 20 to 180 keV. But when we looked at a very long set of data set from AstroSat CZTI, we have actually detected polarization in the range 100 to 500 keV. I'm not going to say anything more about it here because this result is to be announced shortly, and you'll get to hear about it when it does. So I'll go over to the polarimetry of gamma ray bursts. This is in the last set of sources that I'll describe. So detection of gamma ray burst polarization has been an ongoing effort for a long time, starting from the Compton Gamma Ray Observatory. The BATSA experiment tried to do Compton polarimetry on a few gamma ray bursts. So, and then RHC reported detection of a couple of gamma ray bursts, but then the analysis method was contested. So it's not clear whether those results stand or not at the moment. Integral has produced a measurement of a few bursts, and then this gamma ray polarimetry detector on the Japanese Icaros mission, which is a solar sail mission, also produced a few measurements. The Polar satellite, which is a Chinese satellite, which was launched in 2016, worked for 7 months, produced a detection of 5 gamma ray bursts. And AstroSat is the largest, is producing the largest number of detections of polarization right now. In the first year of operation, it detected 6 gamma ray, polarization from 6 gamma ray bursts, and it continues to detect. We have not reported beyond the first year as yet, so I will detect, I will concentrate on the polarization detection in the first year, plus a few others which we have detected individually rather than as a sample. So I'll quickly go through this. The gamma ray bursts are highly relativistic and they produce collimated outflows with, let's say, the jet opening angle denoted by theta j and a high gamma factor. So the gamma factor causes the emission to be confined within a cone of 1 over gamma. And if you're observing this at an angle theta v, which is this is the line of sight to the observer, then a 1 over gamma cone around this theta v is what you will observe at any given time. Now, the gamma ray bursts in the spectra typically have a shape like this. It's a double Pauli spectrum. At low energy, you have a Pauli index alpha. High energy, you have Pauli index beta. So now, when you look at polarization of gamma ray bursts, if the jet, as you see it face on, has, let's say, toroidal magnetic fields, which are ordered, and you see 1 over gamma cone over here, which is a small fraction of this, then you would expect a strong polarization because field is more or less ordered over here within this cone. And in such a case, you would see as a function of view angle, you see a strong polarization here, and it will go out. As you go out of the jet width, the view angle goes out of the jet width, it will drop. If, on the other hand, the field distribution is random, then in an inner point like this, the polarization will all be uniformly distributed in all directions and it will cancel. But if your view axis is close to the edge of the jet, then some part of it will have polarization in this direction, the other part doesn't have emission. So therefore, this anisotropy will cause emission to be polarized to a decent degree, up to about 50% the polarization one can expect in random field, but only at such angles, not beyond that. On the other hand, if you have bulk comptonization, then whatever was the 90 degree angle in the rest frame of the electron, in the moving frame, that angle becomes 1 over gamma. So at the edge of the 1 over gamma cone, you can see a very strong emission going all the way up to 100%. So the Compton drag can produce a very strong polarization, stronger than synchrotron emission in such highly collimated relativistic outflow. Now, what we have from different measurements so far, in Astrosat, you have these black points in 1 year, so this is 6 detections, and these black arrows, which are upper limits. So total of 11 measurements here. Other instruments have contributed so far, that have contributed so far are integral, gap, this the COSI detector, which was flown on a balloon. So they have contributed about 4 or 5 detections over here. And Polar, which have 5 detections over here. So this is the net known set of gamma bus polarization measurements. As you can see, the polar measurements tell us that the average polarization integrated over gamma burst tend to be not very much, relatively low, 10% or so, or less. On the other hand, there are several bursts that we have detected from Astrosat which have fairly strong polarization, quite strong polarization. And many of them are not, because we have not detected. The upper limits tell us that polarization is not measurable with Astrosat. So, according to the Polar group, that if you average over the entire duration of the GRB, you tend to get low polarization because the polarization angle could be changing with time within the burst. So, time resolved analysis of GRBs are important. And Astrosat has actually enabled this study, time resolved spectropolarimetry of gamma ray bursts. Take a couple of more minutes. So just a few examples of what Astrosat has been able to do. This is one of the GRBs that Astrosat has measured, where the spectrum at lower energy is steeper than the synchrotron line of death, which is this plus 1/3 spectrum I mentioned in flux. So that is minus 2/3 spectrum in photon counts. So alpha equal to minus 0.67 in photon counts, which is plus 1/3. So if it is steeper than this, then what could be the origin of that emission? That emission at lower energies, of course, it is not as steep as in the self-absorption, but let's say steeper to near to the power of plus 1 or something like that. So that can come from either jitter radiation. Jitter radiation occurs when a particle which is trying to do synchrotron radiation, but because of scattering, its full orbit is not completed. And it keeps getting scattered while doing gyration. So that can cause steeply rising emission at low frequencies. Or you can have subphotospheric emission, which is Compton scatters. And Compton scattering can give you a strong polarization, as you have already seen. So the distinguishing clue between these two is polarization. So in this particular source, we have steep radiation, so it could be either jitter or subphotospheric emission, but jitter radiation has a polarization less than 40%, but astrocyte measurement gives you 85%. So therefore, it rules out jitter radiation and we zero in on sub-photospheric emission as the cause of this emission. So therefore, through the measurement of polarization, one is able to identify which is the more likely source of emission mechanism in this case. Another GRB 171010A, where the spectral shape is normally synchrotron. Spectral shape is normally synchrotron, but polarization was not detected. And this is consistent with V angle Wiedel in the beam, and it could be either synchrotron or a Compton. And it's either random field or Compton emission viewed within the beam. So you don't expect a great deal of polarization. This is another GRB which showed an interesting fact. So this is spectrum hardness ratio, which is as a function of time. It shows a sudden change in spectrum hardness ratio. And it also shows a sudden change in polarization angle exactly corresponding to that. And this is a very interesting feature which has been observed from AstroSat. If you do sum it all up, then you would, of course, detect a smaller degree of polarization because of this angle change, as polar mission describes. But this change in angle with corresponding change in spectrum is something very interesting, and it says something very interesting about the emission region of the source, with one region dominating once, another region dominating at another time, and so on. This is the final GRB I'm going to show, where it has two episodes of emission. The first episode of emission, when you look at it, is spectra. The spectra is best fitted by a black body plus a power law. And the second episode is can be fitted by power law only. Now, polarization is low in the first episode, and polarization is high in the second episode. So this seems to tell us that there is indeed a significant fraction of thermal emission, which is added in the first peak, whereas the second peak is purely non-thermal. So this kind of time-resolved spectropolarimetric study is helping us distinguish various geometries, polarization sources, the emission mechanisms, and so on. So to summarize, the study of polarization can shed light on multiple aspects of radiation mechanism in geometry and cosmic sources. Detection of polarization at X-ray and gamma ray energies has been a very difficult task owing to the paucity of photons and instrumental systematics. The next decade promises to be a very active one in this area. And with POLIX, RRI will be a major player. The CZTI has been performing as a capable polarimeter above 100 kV. It has detected CRAB, it has detected Cygnus X1, and several gamma ray bursts. And the time-resolved spectropolarimetry, which is enabled by it, is proving to be a crucial tool to decipher high-energy emission processes. Thank you very much. I'm sorry that I went over time for quite a bit.
All right. Yeah. So questions, comments? Yes, Ritaban, go ahead, please.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, Ritaban.
Yes. Hi. Yeah.
So towards the beginning of the talk, you mentioned X-ray polarization, polarized X-rays from accretion disk.
Yes.
So I was wondering, so in case of optical or UV, we don't really see polarization from accretion disk emission.
Yeah. So optical or UV will come from higher, further out in accretion disk. Right, so and in that region of the accretion disk, the main opacity is coming from free-free or even absorption, so you will not get much polarization. So only when the disk is very hot, Thomson scattering dominates as an opacity. And there you get many X-rays, and not very much.
But even the very hot part will also emit a sort of optical as well, right?
So that will be at the if you look at the spectrum, it will be much less than the X-rays. Like, the peak of the emission is in X-rays.
Okay.
Hello. Whether it is a hadronic or electronic emission, how polarization data can fail?
Okay, so whatever I have described so far is entirely leptonic. The hadronic emission, the polarization due to hadronic emission has actually not been explored so much in the literature, because the in the kind of sources that you are talking about, the source emission mechanisms, the hadronic emission will be much fainter than the leptonic emission. So we have not explored what kind of theoretical exploration of what kind of polarization you might expect has not really taken place. So hadronic emission through nuclear scattering and so on nuclear processes is important in various cases, and I think that's a whole new virgin territory as far as polarization is concerned. One should explore it.
Okay.
Prasoon has a question. Prasoon, please go ahead. Prasoon, can you unmute yourself? Okay. Yeah.
So I had a couple of
questions. Please go ahead.
Yeah.
Hello? Am I audible?
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. I had a couple of questions. One was that you mentioned that in the Bragg's polarimeter, for the Bragg's polarimeter, the it cannot be used like a continuum source, but if I look at different angles, scattering at different angles, that will give us information of polarization at different frequencies, right?
Yeah, so you can, there is a practical difficulty in realizing that, right?
I don't understand why it cannot give.
Then you have to have a rotator for the crystal. So here the crystal is fixed at an angle with respect to the incident source. So yes, so if you if you include all these mechanisms, you have to fly them in a satellite. And so that is a far more complex instrument than what you can really produce. Yeah. So yes, so if you keep changing
this angle, or I can have the detector in a, I can have the detector in an arc also, right?
You will have to have large number of detectors. Yes.
One can have the detector in an arc also, right? Instead of
either you move the detector or you have many detectors.
Okay.
Right. So
the other question,
both of which is complicated.
Was what are?
Yeah. Go on.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. The other question I had was that what are the propagation effects like? So we know of in radio we have Faraday rotations, etc. So what are the propagation effects which will affect the X-ray polarization? And can we get the intervening information about the intervening?
At hard X-rays, at high energy X-rays, the interaction of interstellar medium with X-rays is relatively low. So the amount of imprint that intervening medium generates is small. At soft X-rays below 1 kV or so, we know that there is significant absorption that can take place, and that is mainly photoelectric effect, which removes photons from your line of sight. The change in polarization in distributed interstellar matter due to propagation is likely very, very small. So because you are very far away from both the plasma frequency as well as the resonant frequency. So therefore, you don't get the interstellar plasma affecting the polarization, propagating X-rays very much. But in the neutron star magnetosphere, whatever is the net polarization that you will see will consist of
what?
Effect of propagation through the atmosphere plus the generation.
Yeah. So I see Varun has a question.
What
Varun
was in my mind was the accretion disk and the neutron star atmosphere, because those two are the places.
Yeah, so propagation through the accretion disk is basically a scattering atmosphere. What you will see will be the last last mean free path. Whatever is the final polarization state there is what you will see. And so is true for neutron star atmospheres. So, but not the interstellar medium.
All right. Varun, can you go ahead, please?
Yeah. Hi, Dipanka, sir.
Hi, Varun.
Sir, I had this question about CZTA detector as such, about its ability. I mean, we do hear a lot about this GRB polarimetry from CZTA.
Yes.
But what is the status of this instrument in terms of observing other sources and providing science about other sources, let's say neutron star binaries? Because, like, I mean, in spectroscopy, I think this capability goes much lower than 100 kV, right?
Yes, but polarimetry, because we need to have Compton scattered photons, not just the direct absorption. We need photons above 100 kV. Below 100 kV, you do not produce this double events. So therefore, there is no way we can do any polarimetry.
But spectroscopy, I mean,
Spectroscopy can be done, of course. Spectroscopy can be done up to down to 20 kV.
Yes. So, I mean, is there any study or will it be useful to use CZTI in spectroscopic study? Let's say if one is studying a broadband spectra of a source, which has like, you know, emission across two, three orders of magnitude in kV.
Yeah, yeah. So, for example, we have spectroscopic data from CZT for Cygnus X1, CRAB, a few other binary sources and so on. So it just depends on how much photons you have accumulated. And spectroscopy can be done.
Okay. Another question I have is, what is the speciality of these two sources apart from large flux? CRAB and Cygnus, that makes them target of polarimetry measurements? The high flux.
This is primarily flux. So CoX1 is also something that has been used for as a target, but right now only upper limits exist. Mm-hmm. And Cygnus X1 is another very strong X-ray source. So that is one of the targets. And that is one case where there has been a report. But in case of SCO X1, all the observations have been made. There is no report.
Even Nirmal is involved in a team where they had tried to use a different source, if I remember. But their results came out to be null results.
Yeah, so there are other sources which have been targeted, but results are null so far.
But primarily because of the high flux, there could be measurements in this.
Yeah, yeah. So what you target is the brightest sources, because you need a lot of photons to do these measurements. Mm-hmm.
And last question, I think Bishwit will be able to answer it better, is, we have Thomson working in 10 to 30 kV, I guess, right? And CZTA is between 100 to 300 kV. I mean, like, how does one make a polarimeter in between these two ranges, like 30 to 100 kV or so? Like, is it just different scatter material or different geometry, or are there some mission proposed in that energy range?
Yes, the even this COSI is supposed to be in that range. The POGO also goes down to lower energy ranges. So you can, it just depends on how your geometry is. In CZTI, we are using the pixels of the same detector, and it's a high atomic weight material to get our Compton scattering. But you can have one material scattering and another material detecting, like in POLIX, and you can have scintillators being used as detector, something else as scatterer. So depending on the material you use, you can tune the energy range at which it will work.
Okay. Okay. So thank you.
I can ask Biswajit to elaborate further, perhaps.
Biswajit, I think you have to unmute yourself. You are unmuted, okay. We can't hear you. Can everybody hear Biswajit?
No.
I can't hear.
I cannot.
No, we can't hear you.
Hello?
Okay, we can hear you now.
Okay.
Now it is.
So, above the Thomson polarimeter energy range, let's say 30 kV, and below astrosat range, let's say 100 kV, in that band, the most efficient polarimeter would be if you have a hard X-ray focusing optics along with a scattering polarimeter. Scattering polarimeter of the type that Santosh has developed at PRL. So that actually is part of a proposal that we have submitted to ISRO and is under consideration.
Okay.
And
okay.
Okay,
thank you.
Okay. So any other questions?
I have a question on the crab polarization.
Yeah.
In the hard X-rays, I understand if the emission is entirely from close to the neutron star. But in soft X-rays, what was measured with OSO-8, the emission must have been partly from the neutron star and partly from the supernova remnant.
Okay, so complete your question, please. I thought you were...
Yeah, so the angle of polarization in both soft and hard X-ray being in the same direction, is that a puzzle?
It is an interesting observation. It may not be a puzzle in that sense. Let me just go back to that here. So in OSO-8, they deliberately left out the pulsar. Okay. They only took the off pulse region and then they did the polarization measurement. So it is stated as an off pulse measurement. So they said that they wanted to measure the nebula. Now, if you look at the map of the nebula and X-rays, then the strongest emission comes from close to the pulsar and then the knot, which is very near the pulsar, which is still within the wind zone before the first wind termination shock. So the magnetic field, which is being carried by the electron positron wind, the signature of that is still present well beyond that knot.
Okay.
And so therefore, even if some of the emission is not from the pulsar, you will still find the geometry of the magnetic field not too far from the region which is just outside the light signature of the pulsar. It could be slightly different, but not a great deal different. So here also, I think the angle just becomes a little smaller as you go to higher and higher energies and move closer and closer to the pulsar. So there is a change, slight change in angle. So as long as your emission originates from within the wind termination shock, you should still expect the rotational plane of the pulsar being reflected.
Thank you.
All right.
I have a question.
Any other questions or comments?
Yeah, somebody.
Yeah, please go ahead.
So Ashwin here.
Ashwin.
Yeah. Sir, you had shown a slide of simulations by Messrs. Arrows, if I'm right.
Yes.
Can we just...
I'll bring that up.
Yeah. So here, the dip that we see in the spectrum, is that a cyclotron line?
Yeah, that's a cyclotron line. That's correct.
Okay, so there are two things. One is set of squares and circles. So this is essentially telling us that, you know, for different modes of polarization, you see cyclotron absorption and not.
Yes.
I see.
So clearly, if your electric vector is parallel to the magnetic field, then that is not going to excite cyclotron transition.
Right.
So you will not see the dip. Whereas if it is perpendicular to the magnetic field, then that is what is going to move the electron from one Landau level to another. So you'll see the dip over there.
I see. So one question I have here is regarding this. Based on the luminosity, of the source, the brighter the source, will the depth of the cyclotron line shift significantly because of the amount of polarization that we see? Because you might see more of the other mode, or will there any correlation between the two, the luminosity of the source and the cyclotron line depth, perhaps?
There could be. I mean, that the both the cyclotron line depth and the degree of polarization depends on many factors, including the way the material is distributed near the polar cap, the view geometry, and things like that. So one single answer may be difficult, but it can be modeled. And this is something that we are trying to develop. There are no predictions as of today, which is going to immediately tell you what is the luminosity dependence of all these features. But we expect that this tool will be developed in a few years' time, by the time the data from these new missions become available.
So one other question that I had is, you have different geometries when accretion happens. We have a pencil beam geometry, and we have fan beam geometry.
Yeah.
And the luminosity at which this transition happens from pencil beam to fan beam is what we call a critical luminosity.
Yes.
And I believe that, I think in one of the recent results, there is a dependence of the polarization on the geometry.
That is correct.
That happens. And the other problem that we have is we cannot exactly calculate the critical luminosity of sources right now, because we have typical parameters coming in. In that we feed in, and we don't know the mass and the radius of the neutron star. And the magnetic field strength that we choose is also from the cyclotron line that we determine. So by looking at the polarization data, can we constrain the critical luminosity to a certain value? Or
that is one of the goals of polarization measurement.
I see.
Hoping that you will be able to find this transition between pencil beam and fan beam, because polarization will suddenly change. So if you are able to do these polarization measurements well, that is one of the results that one expects.
So we can put a constraint, strong observational constraint on the critical luminosity.
Yes, yes, sources. That is correct.
Right.
That's one of the drivers of this, science drivers of this.
All right. So any other? Yeah. Any other questions or comments? If not, I had a question. So this GMRT pulse and the AstroSat pulse, where you have shown for, I think, crab pulsar, right?
Yeah. This one.
So, yeah, the slide. Yes. So there is a bump actually in before the first pulse in the radio, which
picker,
doesn't
sir.
Seem to appear in AstroSat CJT.
No, this is in radio.
But you don't see it in.
No, it is not seen in X-rays. It is seen in radio.
All right.
It's called the precursor.
Okay. All right. Okay. Right. So any other questions or comments for Deepankar? If not, let us thank Deepankar once again, and Biswajit too. And yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.